optimism left over from Friday, but we'll see what happens.
All right, those are today's market minutes. Now let's take a deep dive into the Bloomberg. You can find all the following charts using the function at the bottom of the screen.
So we're going to take a look at lots of different ways of Valiant. I'm looking at Valiant stock versus one of its bonds. So this white line here is a Valiant bond that's due in 2025.
Here we have Valiant's outstanding debt, and you can see it's just been an enormous
companies. That's what their playbook has been.
The classic roll-up strategy.
What happens now that the capital markets may not be as open to them? How about how much they owe and by when? This is a Bloomberg function here called DDIS. It's debt distribution, and what you see here are the blue bars, which show the bond principal that's due. It starts showing up and say, lay out what the Fed needs to do tomorrow. So what exactly is on Janet Yellen's to-do list?
Dovish, the dollar will eventually rally because they're still going to be so removed from those market expectations.
I mean, they're not looking at the experiential part of the economy, which is the part that's been gaining a lot of steam versus people just buying stuff. Right, Alex?
Well, and that's one thing we like to look at.
I'm Scarlett Fu. What'd you miss? Buybacks are more important to the stock market than QE was to treasuries. According to HSBC, equities have had their own QE since 1982, when new rules made it easy for U.S. companies to repurchase their own shares. By contrast, the Fed's bond buying program lasted only 6 years. We've got a chart that shows it all. And it's pretty amazing, corporate stock buybacks and how they're a huge source of demand for equities. Now, according to HSBC, buybacks totaled 2.6 trillion.
Buybacks are this important to the equity market. What happened?
Their shares, even though they had the cash, but it was stocked overseas.
Right.
Well, this is the other side of the equation, other than
Berg, or I should say the S&P Dividend Aristocrat Index has outperformed those companies that have bought back shares, as well as the S&P 500. So people are definitely moving more in favor of dividend paying stocks.
And of course, go ahead, Tracy.
I was just going to say, I mean, the other thing to think about, it sounds all doom and gloom, but remember, if companies are buying back lots of their stock, we don't have as many shares outstanding. And so the people chase after those and the premium goes up.
Good point.
All right, what is the tipping point for the Federal Reserve to raise rates? Looking at what are its options in terms of telegraphing to investors, to the market, what its options are if things get worse. Narayana Kartralokota, the former Minneapolis Fed president, wrote something for Bloomberg View recently, which was an interesting take. Ted Cruz, because his tax plan is $8.6 trillion smaller than Donald Trump's $9.5 trillion.
Right, but nevertheless, it's still going to increase the deficit with those big spending cuts.
I'm Scarlett Fu. What'd you miss? Some analysts are tempering their forecast for FedEx when the company reports earnings on Wednesday. The reason? Higher than expected peak season costs. Let's see what the numbers show in today's The Numbers Don't Lie. So FedEx's revenue grew at a 5-year compounded annual rate of 6% plus through fiscal 2015. Its ground segment, which is the white line there, was really the star last quarter, gaining more than 30%. E-commerce was a key driver, and if you look at the industry's growth trajectory in the U.S. over the past decade, it's pretty clear that this is a straight shot up. Analysts expect this trend to continue, with sales expanding at a 10% compounded annual growth rate through 2019. That works out to 4 times faster than the overall economy. As for FedEx's profitability, management is targeting annual operating margins of at least 10% over the longer term. The FedEx ground business, and that's the white line, surpasses that 10%, though you can see that its margins have declined in each of the past 3 years. And the reason why there is because e-commerce boosts a demand for less profitable business-to-consumer packages. One potential drag on FedEx is weakness in the industrial economy. The ISM Manufacturing Index, right here behind me, declined steadily last year and is still near its low for the cycle. Growth in FedEx freight and the ground's business-to-business sector could be under some pressure as a result. One thing investors will be watching for, details on FedEx's proposed acquisition of TNT Express. This move should boost its market share in Europe, where FedEx has historically trailed its competitors UPS and DHL. That transaction is expected to close sometime this year. FedEx reports earnings after the close of U.S. trading on Wednesday. Alex?
Good stuff.
I'm Scarlett Fu. What'd you miss?
Do not miss this. UK Chancellor of the Exchequer, George Osborne, will be speaking at 8:30 a.m. on the budget. They're in a really tough bind here. Like, they really need more money, but the fiscal constraints that they have to reach their budget goal by 2020 makes it very difficult to do that.
You should just be finance minister and be done with that.
Thank you.
Okay. Also, CPI here in the United States for the month of February will be coming out at 8:30 a.m. Probably won't sway the Fed decision, but inflation pressures do seem to be building.
All right, Fed decision. I almost feel like I I don't need to mention this, but tomorrow is FOMC day. The vast majority of economists surveyed aren't expecting a move by the Fed, but you never know.
You never know. Maybe they'll take a page out of the BOJ's book. Don't miss our special 2-hour